4. The Residence, Dunkeld, Glengarry, Skymarch, Federated Commonwealth. 11:15 hours, 10th of March, 3057. "Sit down, Davis," Grayson said, indicating a chair on the other side of the desk.
"Sire, I..."
"Sit down, man, and quit towering over me like your damned Highlander." He waited while McCall took a seat, the medals on his chest clinking with the movement, then pressed ahead. "I can't accept your resignation, Major," Grayson continued in a hard and level voice. "Damn it, man, we need you. I need you."
"I'm sorry, Colonel, I truly am, but there are personal reasons."
"Your family? On Caledonia?" McCall nodded. "I thought you weren't on speaking terms with them."
"Well, I've had a message from home."
McCall hesitated, as though trying to decide how to say what he had to say.
"Sire, it's my brother, Angus. He's been placed under arrest by the Caledonian government, and there's been some kind of uprising. I don't know what the whole story might be, but I got to get there, and quickly."
Grayson shook his head. "I don't understand. What can you do?"
"I don't know, not yet. But you must understand, Colonel, with Angus gone, I am the McCall now. They'll be needing me at Glen Eyre."
"Glen Eyre?"
"My family's wee estate outside of Dundee."
"An estate, huh? I had no idea you were so well off, Davis. Maybe I should talk to you about the Great Death's financial situation."
"Oh, well, I'm not, sir, not really. But there is some money in the family, aye. The McCalls were first family, sire, back in the early colonizing days. Put up part of the capital for the colonist ship that brought them out from Terra. A number of McCalls have been governor of the place."
Grayson leaned back in his chair, stippling his fingers as he stared appraisingly at the big Scot. There was an opportunity there.
"Your brother?"
"Angus Charles McCall, sire."
"I gather he's not governor.
Who is?"
"A man named Wilmarf, sir."
"The word governor suggests that Caledonia is being run from someplace else, but it's not a Steiner term."
"Oh, aye. The title dates back to 3 centuries ago, when the Curitas conquered themselves a good part of the Lyran Commonwealth."
"The battles for Hesperus, too."
"Aye, and the 4th Royal Guards held out of Caledonia for 7 long years against the worst old Hugai and the Draconis Combine could throw at them. They lost in the end, though, and the Curitas damn near scorched the whole bloody world. We Caledon was a long time in recovering, and during the next century or two she was ruled from off-world, first from Hesperus II, right next door, and then, when the Lyran Commonwealth was back on its feet, from the Commonwealth capital at Farcod. The governor was appointed by the Steiners, and approved by a vote of the Caledonian High Council. Usually he or she was a native Caledonian whose name was submitted by the council in the first place. The appointment became a mere formality, don't you see?"
"I take it this, Wilmarf, you said, I take it from your tone of voice that he's not a Caledonian."
"I don't know much about him, no," McCall said, shaking his head. "The word is, though, he was a toady to the Davians, and got his appointment as some kind of reward, back a few years."
Grayson considered this. This whole damned political situation was made a hell of a lot worse by the fact that he himself had been named Baron of Glengarry by the highest-ranking Davion of all, Prince Victor Ian Steiner Davion. Grayson Carlyle owed his own position as ruler of this world to a similar reward from the Davions, and every day he was feeling more and more backed into an extremely uncomfortable corner. As though reading his thoughts, McCall caught himself, eyes opening wide.
"I didn't mean, Colonel."
"It's all right, Davis. I know you weren't calling me a Davian toady, but it's a damn tight spot, no matter how you look at it."
"Aye, sire, 'tis all that, indeed."
Throughout the 300 years known as the Succession Wars, the Lyran Commonwealth, ruled by House Steiner, and the federated sons of House Davion had been two separate states, each encompassing hundreds of star systems from the neighborhood of Terra clear out to the periphery, albeit in opposite directions. Sometimes they'd fought. More often they'd been allies, particularly in their ongoing border struggles with House Kurita and House Liao. In all those years of war, none of the 5 great successor states had been able to win the upper hand over the others, but all that changed when Prince Hans Davion and Melissa Steiner had married in 3022, allying their two powerful states and tipping the balance once and for all in favor of the newly created and formidable Federated Commonwealth. If the political marriage of Hans and Katrina was an amicable one, however, the marriage of the two states was not. There had been strains on that alliance from the beginning. The Second Sky Rebellion that had engulfed Glengarry, among other worlds, just a year ago, had been an attempt by pro-Steiner separatists to break the old Sky March away from a political superstate that was now becoming increasingly monolithic and remote from the needs of its citizens. The defeat of the separatists did not mean that the discontent was any less. Quite the contrary, in fact. The appointment of Caledonia's outsider of a governor was scarcely an isolated instance. Many high government offices once held by people loyal to the Steiners had been awarded to pro-Davion individuals after 3022, and resentment had been running high in those circles for years now, especially as Prince Victor had begun working behind the scenes to consolidate his own power after Hans Davion's death. Duke Ryan Steiner, the longtime leader of the Free Sky movement, had been conveniently assassinated after the rebellion had been put out last year. Then Prince Victor had replaced Ryan's number two man with the strongly pro-Davion David Sandoval as both Duke and Marshal of the March. This mingling of the military with the civil authority felt like the imposition of military rule to most of the citizens of the March. Grayson could understand why they were growing restless. Unfortunately, these political entanglements and the unraveling of the old Steiner-Davion alliance promised to make plenty of trouble for units like the Grey Death Legion, and for men like Grayson Carlyle. Technically, Grayson Carlyle owed his primary liege responsibility first to David Sandoval, the Duke of Sky, and then to Victor, who'd named Carlyle Baron of Glengarry in the first place. The Grey Death Legion's original mercenary contract, however, was with the Steiners, and extended clear back to the days before the Federated Commonwealth had been formed. Fedcom Milcom, the Federated Commonwealth Military Command, or Com Squared, as most military professionals called it for short, was the current legal executor of the contract. Personally, however, and emotionally, Grayson's loyalty still resided with House Steiner. It was a curious thing, he thought, this concept of loyalty in a mercenary unit. By definition and by popular supposition, mercenaries were supposed to be loyal only to their paycheck, and a better offer could turn this week's enemy into next week's employer. In fact, though, things were rarely that simple. While some mercs jumped from employer to employer, the best professionals and the ones that commanded the highest prices on the military market were the ones who demonstrated they could be relied upon over the long run. Few employers were willing to risk their C-bills on a merc unit with a reputation for jumping contracts. There was much to be said, too, for the fraternity among combat veterans. When you fought side by side with someone, sharing the dirt and the danger, the triumph and the grief, it was hard to think of him as an enemy after that. There had been a number of incidents throughout history of mercenary units that once had been comrades meeting as enemies in battle and refusing to fight. The history of the Grey Death was inextricably bound up with the recent history of the old Lyran Commonwealth. While the Legion had served other employers, notably House Marek for a time, they'd always come back to the Steiners, fighting first the Draconis Combine in that never-ending trade of blow and counterblow up and down the Commonwealth Combine border, and then the clans, when those high-tech descendants of an ancient Star League-era Exodus had come swarming in from beyond the dark periphery and from the direction of the galactic core. And now, the political cords that bound the Federated Commonwealth together were rapidly fraying. Many people of the Lyran sector of the Federated Commonwealth felt neglected by the preference Victor was giving to things Davion. Added to that, the Lyrans had suffered severely in the war with the clans, while the Davion half of the Alliance had not been touched. It was a quandary for Grayson Carlyle. His personal sympathies were with the people and with House Steiner, while his legal authority and the money came from Victor Davion. And sooner or later, he knew, that web of conflicting loyalties was going to trap him and the Grey Death Legion as well.
Sir?
Grayson looked up at McCall, aware that his mind had wandered.
Sorry, Davis. What was that?
I said, Colonel, that if the Grey Death is sent to Caladan, it'll put us under that bastard Wilmarf's command. With all due respect, I don't think I can stomach that. The man sent battle mechs against a civilian demonstration. I saw it with my own eyes on a newscast downloaded from HPGNet.
And you wouldn't care to be in a mech on Caladonia following his orders. I understand that.
Aye, but it's more than that. I must go and see if I can help my family, my brother. Do you see, sir? It'd place you and me against one another. And if I remained under your command, it would force me to choose between you and my family.
Such decisions, Grayson realized with a small, cold shock, had been the tragedy of civil wars since the beginning of human history.
I understand that.
I wish there was another way.
Tell me, Davis, does this trouble on Caladonia have anything to do with your Jacobite friends?
Oh, aye. McCall gave a wry smile. When there's trouble on Caladon, like as not, the Jakes are in on it.
The smile froze in place, then vanished.
Sir, you'll not be wanting names, of course.
Good God, no, Grayson said, holding up a hand. What do you take me for, man?
Sorry, sir, McCall said, relaxing slightly. But if the Legion goes to put down...
It's a damned big if, Davis. What I want right now is to understand the situation. If the Legion does get dragged into this mess, I want to know the score. But I don't want you to name friends or kin who might be involved, and you don't have to tell me a damned thing if you don't want to.
Thank you, sir.
McCall looked relieved, but it was obvious he was trapped between conflicting loyalties. Like Grayson himself.
The Jacobites,
McCall continued after a moment's thought, are like a political party in some ways, like a brotherhood or secret lodge in the others.
They pride themselves on a lineage they claim goes back to ancient Scotland on Terra, but there's no way they could prove such a claim. They won't restore an ancient monarchy as ruler over Caladan. Though that is as much for pride's sake as for any reasonable legal claim. Their politics, though, call for a constitution that limits the size and power of any government. It's as though they were saying, if their neighbor cannot run his own house and finances, why should he be given power to run my house and finances as well?
A reasonable enough question.
Governments tend to dislike such groups,
McCall said with a flash of dark humor.
Though I cannot understand why.
And this demonstration Wilmarf put down with Max, it was the Jacobites?
To tell the truth, sire, I don't know. They were involved, aye, but the accounts mentioned another group as well, a religious group called the Word of Jihad.
That's all we need, to mix religion with politics. Grayson frowned. Word of Jihad? I've never heard of it.
Aye, sire, nor I either.
McCall looked thoughtful.
Judging from the slogans of some of the banners in the demonstration, however, I'd say that the Jihad is some kind of anti-tech movement. It would figure, of course. The Jacobites have never been too happy with the machines at all, especially with all the Curita Max stomping to and fro across their grain fields and villages for years on end. A Neo-Luddite movement might well find fertile ground there on Caladan.
Neo-Luds, eh?
McCall nodded, and Grayson crossed his arms, sitting back in his chair. The original Luddites had been a loose political group back on Terra in the 19th century, laborers mostly, who feared losing their jobs to the machines of the Industrial Revolution, and who'd sought to fight back by acts of sabotage. In the 12 centuries since that time, new groups with Luddite philosophies and fears had risen time after time, and on world after world. With the battle mech as the visible manifestation of all machines, it was particularly easy nowadays to point to technology as the evil threatening to tear civilization apart and ultimately destroy humanity. Grayson had little patience with such arguments. If technology threatened humanity through weapons, it also offered civilization its one real hope for ending the age-old cycle of want, ignorance, and warfare.
"I know how you feel about the anti-technology sorts," McCall said. "Still, they're not so much evil as misguided."
"Agreed. And if they find themselves armed with rocks against battlemechs, they're likely to find out just how misguided they've been."
McCall's eyes closed, as if at some remembered pain.
"Aye," he said softly, "that's true enough."
Grayson turned to his computer monitor, cleared it of report forms and orders, and called up the Legion's library net, part of the same planetary data system that McCall had accessed for word about Caladonia. It was a continuously updated encyclopedia of worlds, personalities, events, and groups across the inner sphere, assembled on the theory that what was happening on a neighboring world might one day be part of a political or tactical problem facing the Legion's battle staff.
"Word of Jihad," Grayson said, addressing the computer. "Screen only."
As text flickered across the screen, he felt a stab of disappointment. The database offered painfully little information on the group, which in any case must have appeared quite recently. It had apparently begun as a heretical offshoot of the Unfinished Book Movement, a quasi-religious order founded a century before in the Federated Suns, and dedicated to the unification of the various great faiths. The Unfinished Book referred to the fact that there was still much spiritual truth to be discovered. The Word of Jihad had evidently decided to write a chapter or two of its own, for the only mentions of the new movement appeared in reports of rioting and insurrection on Federated Commonwealth worlds from Rigel Kent and New Earth to Carstairs. So far, at least, it appeared to be confined to the Sky March, but the movement's spread was being discussed in Farcod and in New Avalon, the twin capitals of the Federated Commonwealth. There was a growing concern that the Word of Jihad, which, as McCall had suggested, thought that machines were evil, would spread beyond the Sky March to other areas of Fedcom space.
"Interesting," Grayson commented aloud, as he read the little that was known about the Jihad movement.
"It says here the Word of Jihad thinks the end of the universe is about to take place."
"Indeed, sir?"
"Yes. They claim that there's to be a great tribulation, a time of blood and unceasing warfare, lasting 300 years, followed by a time of cleansing, when everyone uncontaminated by the demonic spirit of machines will be empowered by God to destroy all machines and put an end once and for all to war."
Grayson cocked an eyebrow at McCall.
3 centuries of tribulation? That could be the Succession Wars, I suppose, measured from the death of the first Lord Simon Cameron.
"That was, what, Colonel, 2750, or 51, thereabouts? They're a wee bit past their time if they think that, unless they're in their time of cleansing right now."
"Apocalyptic religions aren't always logical about their dating systems. That 3 centuries could be measured from the Amaris coup, too. That pretty much started the collapse of the Star League, and that was 2766.
Either way, I can see how the idea would excite them, McCall said. After 3 long bloody centuries, and one house knocking another into rack and ruin, they see a time coming soon with no mechs, no damned invading armies, no war.
Paradise. But I'm afraid I don't see that happening.
Nor I, Colonel. Not that that'll stop them from trying to take on battle mechs with stones. The damned poor fools.
Grayson blanked the screen, then turned his face to his officer. Major, he said bluntly, I cannot accept your resignation.
McCall's face fell first, then hardened into a stubborn and recalcitrant glower.
Sir, I'm very sorry to hear you say that.
Shut up, Davis, before you commit an act of mutiny.
Sire, I said shut up, not another word.
McCall's jaw clamped firmly shut, though his eyes continued to smolder. Grayson touched a key on the console pad of his desk.
Santley?
A man's voice replied from the outer office.
Yes, Colonel?
Track down Captain Carlyle, please. I want him here in my office immediately.
Yes, sir.
Looking again at McCall, Grayson waved his hand.
For God's sake, stop glowering at me, Mac.
He indicated the far wall of the office, where a small but well-stocked bar resided behind a sliding panel. Go fix yourself a drink. I think there's still some of that Glenlivet you like so much. Caught between stubbornness and an automatic obedience, McCall started to rise, hesitated, then did as Grayson had commanded.
Sire,
he said after a moment, while pouring 3 fingers of golden liquid into a glass filled with ice.
May I speak?
Of course, Grayson said. I didn't mean to be abrupt. In here, with just you and me, you can call me whatever you damn well please.
McCall broke a wry grin. Well, no, I was not about to call your names, sire, but I did wonder what had crossed your mind. I must return to my family. Do you see that, sir? I must, if I have to desert to do it. Your orders leave me very little choice.
You desert the Legion, Mac? Grayson's voice was soft as velvet.
McCall did not answer right away. I would not like to be put in the position where I would have to choose.
We may all have to choose before long, old friend. Grayson hesitated, then grinned.
Mac, there's no reason at all for you to resign your commission. Not when I'm just about to assign you to detached duty.
McCall's eyes widened slightly, and the golden liquid in the glass he held sloshed a bit.
Detached duty, sir? You're not thinking of sending me to...
Caledonia, Mac. You're going home, and I want you to take my son with you. What do you think of that?
I think, sir, McCall said, choosing each word deliberately, that the Colonel has lost his bloody mind, sir.